three, maybe four serious jazz rock or jazz fusion bands. There was Weather Report, Mobbish and Orchestra, Return Forever, and maybe you can put Larry Coryell's band in there. And what happened, and Miles Davis was sort of the precursor,
yeah.
And even before Miles Davis, Tony Williams' Lifetime, mm-hmm. which actually he inspired Miles. You know, okay. When you look at all that, and then what happened after that is each one of these bands broke up, and these guys formed bands, and then these guys broke up and they formed bands,
yeah.
So the music got, was became, what's the word, dissipated. And that would have been more accurate to say, well, this band, this fusion band that kind of has the trumpet player who played with the guitar player, who played with the drummer, who played
yeah.
with the, who knew the manager of the guitar player from Weather Report.
Yeah.
You know, if you know anything about physics,
yeah.
chemistry, or how, you know, it all applies,
yes.
you know, we're on this planet. I mean, it dissipates. It's never going to be Miles or Weather Report.
Or so the kind of,
yeah,
the concentration.
Yeah.
Yeah. There,
so,
yeah,
so it's actually unfair to judge those musicians like that. You're going to have a guy like Miles Davis. Miles Davis was a culmination from Louis Armstrong up through Dizzy Gillespie. You know, you're never going to have that again. Maybe 50 years from now you
yeah.
might. You know, Return to Forever and those bands that were there, I feel so lucky and honored that I happened to be at a point, born at a particular moment, arrived in New York, met this individual, this happened. And our band was nothing more than really, I won't say not to belittle it, but it was a culmination of everything that came before that. So this, so when you move further down the time track, and this band here, I can't blame this band
no.
because they don't sound like Weather Report.
No, no.
It's stupid. You know, it's a stupid thing. So that's why I just get a kick. You know,
yeah, but also
I think you know one of the advantages of waiting this long is that we're all better players. You know, I think there's always something nice when I think people have a nice feeling for bands when they're young, like a new
yeah.
band
yeah.
gonna come out in 19, 20, 21, whatever. There's something nice about that.
Sure.
I mean, we surely benefited from that sort of way of looking at
well,
music.
There's a lot of energy in those.
Yeah, you know.
In them, you know?
But to be quite honest, we're better musicians now. You know. Even though I love jazz music, I mean, I wasn't your quintessential 50s jazz musician.
Yeah.
I mean, I came up and I thought it was totally natural to play at Madison Square Garden and play it. You know, I was surprised when I started playing with some of the early people like Art Blakey. I was surprised at the size of the small jazz clubs. I said, boy, this is cool. Wow, playing at this kind of men. Man, Art, you should be playing at bigger places.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I mean, you know, because when I grew up, even though I listened to Miles Davis, John Coltrane, Art Blakey, et cetera, at the same time I listened to Jimi Hendrix, the Beatles, James Brown, Aretha Franklin. I mean, I listened to everything just like anybody else, you know. So I think that was the uniqueness of at that time, the guys that were my age and we played jazz rock music. I used to get a kick out of reviewers and people that used to criticize us as musicians and say, oh, these guys are selling out. I used to laugh so hard about it. I liked it, though.
Because
it used to keep our names in the press.
Yeah,
you know,
of course.
These guys are shit, this, that, whatever. And I, we all knew that we were probably the most honest.
Yeah, yeah.
Because some of the guys that would wear the suits and ties, play their jazz gigs at night, but would come home and throw on an Aretha Franklin record.
Mm.
You know, go dance with their girl to
yeah.
a James Brown record. I mean, we were doing exactly how we grew up.
Yeah.
Know? I mean, I grew up like that. And so our music was a fusion. When they called it jazz rock, that's what it was. I think one of the unique things about Return to Forever was that, you know, specifically looking at the music is the music was constructed much like classical music.
Yeah.
All our music, the ensemble parts were written out in scores. You know, you can look at it, you could give it to an orchestra and conduct it, a lot of the stuff, particularly stuff that Chick wrote. And but the one component that we had in the band that I felt was unique was that we, particularly with me, Chick, and Lenny, is that we were real jazz musicians. You know, we played with like real serious, you know, jazz musicians. And
you've done your time.
Yeah, yeah. And so we brought that element to the band. So when it came to playing solos, our solos, we approached our solos 100% like jazz musicians, not like rock musicians.
Yeah, you
like,
built.
Okay, we got an 8-bar thing here, and I gotta really make it sound good so the radio guy likes it. I mean,
yeah,
that 8 bars might turn into 800 bars. Just to give you a kind of a glimpse of when we came on the scene, like in the early 70s, you know, the jazz music coming out of the 60s, even though Miles Davis had Bitches Brew and what have you, but for the most part, the jazz community was pretty conservative at that time. Guys were wearing suits and ties and playing straight ahead, you know, swing stuff, and which is great. And here, you know, we're coming out doing this stuff, and you know, we didn't get much airplay at all. But we took advantage of our youth, and we played, man, I think 1 year we played 10 months we toured. Wasn't that great for our marriages as young men, but poor girls, they suffered, you know. But you know, we did it, and it was great for our music and for what we were trying to do, and it didn't matter. We kind of out-created the whole radio thing. We were everywhere, playing word of mouth. And in those days, the music business was much more simple than it is today. It was more ground, like on the ground. You know, we didn't have internet. It was like, you know, you go to a town and people wanted to know who was playing at that place. You couldn't just go online and check it out and then say, well, this band, let's go to YouTube and see what they sound like.
Yeah, yeah.
Maybe I like it, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
So people came out, they were curious, you know. And it was a great, great time, you know. And so we were able, because we were kind of on the outside looking in, we were just what we were. Well, as you say, we wore our hearts on our sleeves there, and just we let it all hang out.